this night reserved?
Well, it's, we're going to swap places, don't worry.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Shakespeare and Company. We're delighted to welcome Thad Carhart back tonight to read from and discuss his charming new memoir, Finding Fontainebleau, An American Boy in France. Finding Fontainebleau paints a beautiful portrait of a very special place at a very special time. To a young American boy in the 1950s, Fontainebleau was an enchanting and beguiling vision, a location ripe for adventures, whether in the castle itself, in the surrounding small town, or during weekend visits to Paris. In the warm prose with which he made his name, Thad Carhart enlightens the reader on the enormous influence this settlement just outside of Paris has had on French style, taste, art and architecture, and demonstrates that however well you might think you know its history, it always has more secrets to reveal. Thad Carhart is also the author of international bestseller The Piano Shop on the Left Bank, as well as the novel Across the Endless River. Please join me in welcoming him to Shakespeare and Company.
Thank you, Adam, and thank you all for being here this evening. Just want to make sure, is this being projected? I think it is. Okay, great. Before I begin, I'd like to say just one short word about Shakespeare and Company. Many of you have been here before, I expect, but some of you likely have not. And for those of you who have not, let me add my voice to those who sing its praises. It's not just a bookstore, it's a great bookstore, and we would be lucky anywhere to have a place like Shakespeare and Company. The thing about independent bookstores, and good ones in particular, is that they live on the sufferance of their clients, and that means coming to events like this, of course, but buying too. I'm not pushing my book tonight, I'm just saying in general, it's great if you can support Shakespeare, and if you can, please tell others who may not know about it. It makes a difference for people to hear from someone. Word of mouth is the best thing you can get for an independent bookstore, and I just want to add my word to that long list. So what I plan to do is talk to you a little bit, and really just a little bit, about my book. I'll read some short sections, I emphasize short, and try to give you a flavor for some of the different parts of the book. And of course, I'll be glad to respond to questions afterwards. We'll leave some time for that. And if you do want a book, I'm glad to sign it or dedicate it to however you like. I'll make my remarks in three different areas, three different aspects of the book. That I think will give you an idea without my describing it into the ground. There's nothing worse in my mind than having an author tell you then this, then this, then that. And if I start to do that, you can tell me to stop. The first is really the subtitle, An American Boy in France. So I'll speak to that first and then proceed from there. Hey kids, we're moving to France. Consider, if you will, what that might have sounded like for a four-year-old, when his father came home and yelled that from the front door in a house in Northern Virginia, the suburbs of Washington, D.C. I was that four-year-old boy, and it was 1954, and we were moving to France. And it was the beginning of a long adventure, certainly, but a new aspect, a new part of my life. That wasn't too tough for me because I was so young. I was the fourth of five children, and I hadn't been to school yet, and I certainly didn't know what France was or where it was, and none of us had actually been to France or spoke French. But in that summer of 1954, my dad was, he was a career officer in the Air Force, and he was a staff officer at the Pentagon at the time, and he was assigned to the NATO command headquartered in the Chateau of Fontainebleau. So we moved the entire family over in that summer and became residents of Fontainebleau. Fontainebleau, for those of you who don't know, is just about 45 kilometers south of Paris, maybe more like 50, and not far. And it's certainly not just a bedroom community. It has become a bit of that in modern times, but it's a real separate, somewhat provincial town. Not that big, but its main and abiding feature is the chateau. The interesting thing is my dad was assigned to the chateau, which meant his office was there. He was on the staff of the French commander, Maréchal Juin. So he went from our house, which we rented in town, to the chateau. So that was part of the landscape. But when we arrived in 1954, I must say it was as different as a place could be, in both in my imagination and my experience, and that of my siblings, even my parents. We were, I think it's fair to say, astounded, enchanted in a certain way, but really just floored by the differences, the people and the architecture, the cars, the food, certainly, and of course, most of all, the language. So that was like arriving on Earthlings on Mars and trying to figure it out. Initially, we were not certainly the first Americans who had lived in Fontainebleau. There had been a NATO command there since 1949, but for a big family coming from the suburbs of Washington in the 50s, it was new territory. The chateau, as I say, was part of the landscape. It was also part of the near landscape. My parents rented a house. My dad rented a house. Actually, he always told the story. He had one day to find a house, but there was a great big kind of ramshackle mansion not too far from the chateau that he did rent, and for not very much. And we moved in there. It was a big, it's what the French would call a maison de maître, with an acre of land surrounded by a stone wall. But its interesting feature for us kids was it backed up against the outer gardens of the chateau, which is a public park. So it was kind of perfect for kids with their bicycles to go around those parts of Fontainebleau. The initial moving into the house was tricky. I described that, and I won't get into the particulars here other than to say that everything was about as new to us as could be imagined. I will read you a short bit about that, about one part of moving in, just to let you know what really my mom, who had to deal with it mostly, moving in, five kids, and trying to figure it out. In the first week after we moved in, my mother discovered that the house came with a number of employees whose livelihood was closely associated with its maintenance. Certainly not servants in any conventional sense, they were more a group of retainers who knew the house and its grounds and were, for that reason, indispensable. We had a maid who drove her small motorbike from the outskirts of Fontainebleau three times a week, a gardener who came by every other day, a window cleaner who made infrequent appearances, and a man who cared for the hardwood floors and the big pieces of furniture every month. Painters and tradesmen also showed up irregularly, expecting to be paid for work my parents had not requested. After some initial resistance, my mom and dad acquiesced. Adopting Mademoiselle de Chenville's reasoning, she was the real estate agent who had found the place, adopting her reasoning that the maintenance was usually essential, they did good work, and they were paid very little. But it meant for those first weeks, the house had the feel of a film set, where a new character might walk in off the street and announce, in effect, "I'm in the movie." Returning from an errand in those first days, my mother was startled by an older man in the grand salon, the main room, doing a strange sort of gliding dance across the bare wood floor. Was he drunk? Some daytime prowler on a bender? Then she noticed the large brushes affixed to the soles of his shoes, his movements displaying a rhythmic pattern as he circled slowly, smiling all the while. "What are you doing dancing in my living room with brushes on your feet?" was far beyond her meager French. So she said the next best thing. "Bonjour, monsieur." "Bonjour, madame." This is how she met Monsieur Jérôme, le frotteur, literally the rubber, since rubbing and brushing is how parquet floors are maintained. Who knew? We certainly had no idea about parquet floors or frotteur or any of it, but Monsieur Jérôme came with the territory. The other aspect of our lives that changed immediately, almost immediately, at the end of that summer was the fact, well, for me, I had never been to school, so I went to school, but all of us, my parents made the somewhat weighty decision to send us to French schools rather than to the American section of the schools. So we went off to school in French. I was relatively luckier than my siblings. My elder siblings had been to school in Virginia, and so for them it was really tough. Although what's interesting is that we all adapted, and within several months, had were conversant in French and doing fine in school. But school was another area where it was just very different from the Virginia we had known, the suburbs we had known, I should say. And what struck me the most, I think, was the attitude towards serious approach, even that I was in maternelle, kindergarten, and it was understood that you're here to learn and you don't just talk or carry on. I had, for the first several months, all my report cards had conduite, attention à la conduite, watch out for conduct, because I I talked a lot, which I don't think was that unusual for an American child, but it was unusual and not tolerated in France. So that was part of the landscape too. What quickly established itself was this divide, although it really wasn't a divide, a difference, I should say, between life at home, English, and life outside the home, French. Whether it was school or the townspeople or friends, that was all French. The minute we came home, we were an American family and we spoke English. And it came naturally, but that was new too. So it was a strange reality. I'll read one other little section here to give you a flavor for what school felt like to me for the first time. Each morning began with a strange ritual that I had never before imagined, much less seen. On the first day of school, a girl with long brown hair was given a huge wine bottle. In France, where every size of wine bottle has its own special name, this one was called a Jeroboam and held 3 liters. A boy with thick, wire-rimmed glasses was given a folded hand towel. The teacher whispered her directions to them. Then the two students proceeded down the aisles of desks, pouring ink deliberately and cautiously from the wine bottle into each of our inkwells. Any spills immediately wiped up with a towel. We were then told to prepare a plume, one of the old-style pens with removable nibs, that had to be dipped continually in ink. So began my introduction to the French art of penmanship, still taken in France to be one of the key indicators of one's personality. That was something, the idea that you would use a plume and have ink at your desk, each student at her or his desk, was astounding to me. But I learned to deal with it. One thing I have to point out, I think Viking Penguin did a great job with the package of the book. And one thing they did was include as end papers a copy of my cahier of écriture, which is penmanship, essentially. And the perfect letters are the maîtresse, the teachers, and of course the feeble attempts are my own. And all of us had to do this. Every week we would have several pages of cahier, of écriture in cahier, and that came with the territory too. So just to finish up this part, I'd say that my mom, who hadn't spoken French at all before, none of us had, but she was not going to school, but she was learning. She did take courses in Fontainebleau, but she was also reading my textbooks or my little cahiers to pick up not the sense of it was really writing and sums and reading and so forth, very elementary stuff, but just to see how the French would be phrased. And she said for the thing that struck her was in calcul, which is arithmetic, the fundamental basic sums, said she noticed early on that there were an awful lot of examples that used wine bottles to calculate. If my mother and father have 10 bottles of wine in their cave, in their wine cellar, and my aunt and uncle come to Sunday dinner with 3 bottles, how many of wine bottles will they then have in their cave? This she never could quite get over. My parents drank wine and liquor, but the idea that that would be in a child's textbook was, I think, really very interesting to her and kind of encouraging. To me, it made perfect sense because when we lived in Virginia, we had, perhaps some of you know, it used to be in America, you could have, certainly in the suburbs, you could have milk delivered to your back door. Dairies would come around they had a milk truck, and they would leave whatever your order was in this aluminum insulated box at the back door in these great big glass bottles. in France, with the house that we rented, we had wine delivered. It just came with the house. And there was wine. There were six bottles of wine every 2 weeks. There was two rosé, two vin blanc, two vin rouge. And that just was, my parents weren't big drinkers, but they certainly didn't send it back. And it was, it just became, it made sense to me. You know, Virginia wine, Fontainebleau, I mean, no, Virginia milk, Fontainebleau wine. That just seemed to be part of the picture. The only other thing I'll say is from the French point of view, which took us a while, because it does take a while, it did then and it still does, to get to know your neighbors and to trade, if not intimacies, at least some information about each other. It was really after about a year that one of our French neighbors told us how strange we seemed, not because he hadn't met plenty of other Americans before, and there were other big families, but he said, what really stood out about you was your car. And our car was, in those days, it's actually kind of strange when you consider now, the government paid for you to send not only your household goods, but your car overseas so you could drive your American car, which really is ridiculous when you think of it, but that's what people did. So we sent our car over. It wasn't a luxurious car at all, but it was a big car. It was a Chevrolet station wagon. But the particularity for him was, it was a model called a Woody, which has big panels of wood on the side and is very distinctive and not French. So he said when we rode off, all seven of us in it, it looked like we were, vous conduisez une énorme boîte allumette, and you're driving a big matchbox. Matchboxes in those days were made from little pieces of wood. So I thought later, when I thought about that, you know, we must have really looked like Martians to some of the neighbors at first, because it just wasn't part of the picture. I'll talk now just briefly about another aspect of the book, which is my return. The return, it sounds like the sequel, the return of the native. No, my return to France as an adult in the late 80s. That's part of the book in the sense that it was then, and I was lucky enough to come back for various reasons, but principally because I got a good job in Paris. So that's, I moved here with my wife and our two infant children. And we intended to stay for a few years and then probably move on. But it was coming back to a place I knew, and we went down to Fontainebleau periodically with our own children. What surprised me, and what I hadn't expected or certainly wasn't looking for, was, well, two things. One, we ended up staying indefinitely. In fact, I've been here for 27 years, so that's pretty a pretty long stretch. That wasn't in the cards at the time. And the other thing, and what one of the things that allowed me, was to investigate and find out more about different aspects of France as an adult now that I hadn't known as a child, and in particular Fontainebleau, which I had known, I had appreciated. Certainly the chateau was, it occupied the field in our collective imagination as a family, but I had known it from a child's point of view. And then I came back as an adult and was lucky enough to be able to investigate it further, which I did. At the time, I was writing my first book, Piano Shop, at the time, and I had the good luck to meet the chief architect of Fontainebleau, a gentleman by the name of Patrick Ponceau, who figures prominently in the book, because he and his team are the ones who take care of, maintain, restore, and most importantly, in my mind, present the chateau to the public, both the French public and the many thousands of international tourists who know it and visit it. And it's an extraordinary proposition. Fontainebleau is, when I came to understand it as an adult, quite an extraordinary place. It's 500 years older than Versailles. It's 50 years older than the Louvre. It's, by depending on who's counting and on what day, it's got about 1,500 rooms. It's got 5 acres of roof, and it goes on forever, it seems, in the extent of its variety as well as its sheer size. But it's not just some monster. It's actually one of the things, and one of the delightful things about Fontainebleau, and I don't think it's just because I've known it for years, but many people have said this on their first visit, it coheres in some strange way that you wouldn't expect. It has been occupied by just about every French monarch from 1137 to the last in 1870, when Napoleon III was driven from power. That has been a continuum, a rare one, and almost all of those monarchs have left something in the built environment. Sometimes it's a courtyard, sometimes it's a fountain, a chapel, a room, a statue, you name it. But it's there. And one of the things that's interesting, and I think speaks to the overall respect of the French for their own built environment, is they respected what went before. It wasn't just torn down, hey, let's get rid of this and we'll do another one. It was integrated and used and added to, not destroyed. That, I think, is particularly important. So one whole part of the book, or I should say interleaved throughout the book, is this discussion of the chateau and its restoration and what that means for the narrow world of Fontainebleau, but also for the French idea of the patrimoine culturel, the shared inheritance. It's something we have a parallel to in America, but it's not the same thing. I'd say France is the special place for this idea. It's more than an idea. It's a lived experience, and it's something we can talk to any just about any French person about what matters to them in the local community, and it could be in a far part of France, not just in Paris. And patrimoine comes into it pretty soon. It's quite an extraordinary tradition. What I found, what was interesting to me, was that the Fontainebleau is imbued with royalty. It was built by the kings. And yet it also shows you the power of the République to appropriate the forms of royal legitimacy and make them their own. And without denigrating them or changing them particularly. In fact, there's a strong consensus about restoring and maintaining this site of royal power, but without a reverence for royalty. There's a respect, certainly, for what the artists and some of the kings accomplish, but not this kind of upstairs, downstairs, Downton Abbey aspect of what a great time they had. I think it's what interests me is how it's used as, and I try to focus on this in the book, it's used as a means of educating and explaining the past, what could be more important. I'll just read a brief section here about Patrick Ponceau and one of his curators who were finding, they were restoring the Napoleon III office, which hadn't been touched since 1870. And one of the interesting aspects of restoring a place like Fontainebleau is that there's no intention to restore the whole place. But they want to have representative rooms or suites of rooms that represent the significant periods of French art and architecture. And by and large, they have that. One of the things that has been neglected, one of the parts that has been neglected, is the 19th century, the closest to us in terms of in his case, he wasn't a king, he was an emperor of France, a Napoleon III. And so this was meant to open that final style to the public. So they've just found a little piece of wallpaper under a window surround, and it's a great moment because they didn't know what the wallpaper, what color it was. That was the issue. The curator grasps a few square inches of frayed wall covering hidden from the light for all these years, and this now sparks an animated discussion. You see, it's much different brown from what we thought at first. Avan. The paint color, it happens, is called Avan, Havana, like Cuba. They know this from the notes of their predecessors describing the furnishings and decor of Napoleon III's office when it was first installed in the wing in 1864. And now they have a scrap of the original wallpaper that reveals an important fact. Yes, you're right. Much different. It needs to bring out the warmth of that yellow stripe. This is Havana in the 19th century, not Miami in the 20th. Their energy is that of two boys at a treasure hunt who have just figured out how to use a particularly telling clue. In this, they could be like any pair of designers who are looking for appropriate solutions for an important room, except that the immutable standard for every choice they make, The perilous starting point for every option is historical accuracy. More than any other, this consideration governs their decisions. The constraints are formidable. Ponson sums it up nicely when we talk later in his office. Je suis comme un chef d'orchestre. Je ne peux pas changer une seule note de la partition. I'm like an orchestra conductor. I can't change a single note of the score. Well, yes, I respond, but in a way it's trickier than that. You also have to fill in parts of the score as you go along. He laughed and acknowledged that it sometimes feels that way, but that like a conductor, he has a certain leeway to interpret matters. First, they research the specifics rigorously. This is, after all, a museum, and that consideration is paramount. Ponson told me, once we do our work on the side of history, we must also determine how best to present the result while protecting it from a use for which it was not originally intended. It is a paradox. Well, I don't need to tell you that France is a place where a paradox is a good thing. And this is something that they, it's a challenge, really, but one they rise readily to and go about addressing. And so that's part of the story also, is how do they do this, what are the priorities, and what's what's at stake. Finally, I'll just read later. I'll just talk to you a bit about another part of the book, which is having to do with why this came about, my whole fascination with Fontainebleau. It's not just a fascination with a chateau, I'd like to think, but it's more, for me, it's more an aspect of France, which is represented by the chateau, but I think the chateau is emblematic of a particularly French approach to things over the years, but also in its present manifestation as a site of restoration and as a great museum. Any of you who have lived abroad for part of your lives, and I expect there are some of you here tonight who have, knows that a language has a magnetic pull. Another language, other than your native tongue, has a magnetic pull over the years. It just is part of you. It becomes part of you, whether it's pure bilingualism or just an exposure to the language. But if that's the case, then there's something special in those instances when you come back and you go back and forth across that barrier. We had this when we were children. We called it, in my family, the in-between place, where you were American, certainly. You were living in France. We went back and forth with the two languages. It wasn't troublesome. It just was part of the picture. And we certainly weren't the only ones who did that. But when we went back to the United States, it seemed strange and unusual. Also not particularly different from the experience of many people. But when you're in between two worlds, I think you develop your own approach and your own responses to things that come your way when you're back in the country, in my case France, where you learned the first other language. In our case, we had disconnects all the time when we were children, even when we were in the 50s. It was something that was unusual, disconnects between our American culture and French culture. And then there were great points of overlap. The first one I can remember in particular in our family was, it was rock and roll. What else would it be in the 50s? And there was a guy by the name of Bill Haley, and Bill Haley in the Comets, and you probably won't have heard of him, but trust me, he was a big deal, not just in the United States, but also in France, which was the unusual thing. He was on French radio as well as American radio, and there were French records as well as American records. Rock Around the Clock was his big hit. He lasted for about 6 months, and then there was another guy by the name of Elvis Presley, and that was just a sea wave that just took over. I don't need to go into detail there, but it just was the first time where you really felt as if there's something bigger than this country or my country. It's rock and roll in our instance. It wasn't only that, of course, but that was, as it from a child's point of view, that's what it felt like. That was more true for my older siblings than it was for me. And I'll just give you a flavor for what it was like for me. In my instance, I was 6 years old in 1956. And for me, it was Davy Crockett. And Davy Crockett was one of the biggest, probably the first big marketing, I didn't know it at the time, but of course now as a parent, and since having talked to my parents over the years, said it just was unbelievable what Davy Crockett did. It just occupied everywhere, including France. It was one of the first big Disney pushes for international, the movie and the goods and so forth. So I'll just read one last passage about how this came to me in France. The Davy Crockett craze caught on in France as it did all over the world. Young boys clamored for coonskin caps. I was inseparable from mine for months. And they played in simulated versions of the frontier buckskin costume. We brandished Davy Crockett toy rifles and hunting knives when we weren't reading Davy Crockett comic books. Parents everywhere, including France, were pestered for the board game, the trading cards, even the bubble gum. Some of the French kids at school had bits of paraphernalia, and the ballad of Davy Crockett, born on a mountaintop in Tennessee, was a constant refrain. Never mind the Marshall Plan. Never mind the Berlin Airlift. Never mind NATO itself. At a kid level, this was the first palpable evidence I had that it was cool to be American in Europe. Davy's movie incarnation, Fess Parker, had an initial hiccup in France that no one foresaw. As it happens, the word Fess, pronounced like the actor's given name, Fess, means buttock in French. Fess Parker plays Davy Crockett resonated for the French as Butt Parker. Immediately, his name in French was changed to Fier Parker, meaning Proud Parker. And so it remained through all the iterations and reruns dear to the French. So that's, I hope, an amusing, certainly a child's point of view of at the time. I was sincere about my passion for Davy Crockett, but I wasn't the only one. We were sold a lot of merchandise, or at least our parents were. But it was the back and forth in from a child's point of view that when I returned later, and not just because I had my own children, but I realized how much France had changed and how much it had stayed the same. And there was a lot of the give and take, that in between, what we called given in between in our family, was generalized in the culture at large. I found that to be fascinating and absolutely riveting, and it's one of the things I have tried also to write about in this book. I think the important point is that in-between area, from an adult's point of view as well as from a child's, is a rich and vital area, and it's something that I hope you'll be able to visit when you read my book and understand what that was for me, and I hope to a certain extent what it was like for Americans living in France in the 50s as well as in later times. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, now we're going to open up to questions from the audience. If you do have a question, just raise your hand and the microphone will come round to you, I think. Yeah. Okay. Don't be shy. Who's going to kick us off? Okay. Well,
a very simple question. Did you revisit the house that you lived in Fontainebleau?
That's being amplified. Yeah. Okay. So I don't need to repeat the question. No. Yes, I revisited the house. It's still, I was actually a little afraid that it wouldn't be there because not a lot, but certain parts of Fontainebleau are gone. But it's still kind of pokey as a town, and the house is still there. It's not a house anymore. It's although its structure has been maintained, it's used by an international group of accountants, I think, and they love it. I met the managing director, who said he's criticized by all the other international groups because they say they have their own little chateau. Well, they've gussied it up. I mean, it's extremely. What's interesting is they gutted it completely. It was very. The French would say lugubre, almost, in the inside, heavy, and yet quite beautiful in its way. It had wonderful light, and they took all that out and made it extremely modern in a beautiful way, and yet the shell is exactly, you'd never know from the outside. So it was quite an interesting thing to go in and experience that, but yeah, it's there, and the land is there, so it's an important thing.
Yeah, we'll just get the microphone to you. Yeah. Okay.
It's probably a silly question, but...
It's okay.
No silly questions. No, I mean, there are no silly questions. Your question...
So it's often said about the French, they have a love-hate relationship with the United States, with Americans, or that's certainly been what's been said in the past. And I wonder, growing up, how did people feel about... How do French kids feel about you as an American? Were you the exotic outsider? Were you envied? Were you... both kind of welcomed, not welcomed, and amongst the adults as well. How did your parents integrate into a society that felt ambivalent?
I'm just wondering if people in the back are hearing. You're not. Okay, let me just try to summarize what you asked, and we'll see. The question is what the attitude was towards Americans when we lived there, and also towards my, both as children and for my parents as adults, because there's this background, certainly if it's more than a caricature, of the love-hate relationship between the French and the U.S. First of all, in the 50s, I was a kid, and I just did my kid thing. So that said, when you live in a big family, especially, and we were not standoffish, but we were American. There were other Americans, but we didn't socialize with only other Americans. So we had friends. There were six or seven different nationalities in the NATO command itself. So there were kids from Britain and Canada and Germany eventually and Holland and Belgium. So we knew a lot of those kids. So we weren't, Americans weren't the only exotics by any means. The other thing is, I guess it's fair to say, America, because of Elvis, probably, or Davy Crockett, or some of that stuff, was more in view. So that was, I don't know if it was cooler, but it was, we were meant to have more money. My mom always laughed, said, yeah, we're supposed to be rich. and she never complained about it. We certainly did have, we had a relatively privileged situation. But I'd say her feeling in particular, and she said this often, was the French were entirely welcoming, and there was no distinction. It was on a human level. Every now and then, and I remember as a kid seeing this, and it would be pointed out, and it wasn't, oh my God, the terrible French, but you'd see Yankee go home on a wall or something like that, or some of the communist slogans. You didn't take it personally. It was just understood to be, oh, that's politics or something. But on a human level, people were great. And I'd say that was true. My parents always had a great feeling about France. I mean, that just remained. I'd say all of the members of our family. It's not some golden era. Just really on a human level. I'd say that was. So if that addresses your question, then that was our experience.
Yeah.
Over here.
Yeah. Thank you. I read your book some years ago, The Piano Shop on the West, Bank.
Left Bank. Well.
Yeah, that one too.
You're not the first one to. Mm-hmm.
I'm just wondering, I got two questions. I mean, does that make you, does it mean you're a musician? You're a piano player?
I'm a very amateur piano player, yes, but I do love
and
the keyboard.
Sorry, this is a completely aside because maybe most people don't know this. But could you tell me where that piano shop is?
No. If you read
that
the
was
book,
a mystery.
If you read the book, yeah. You read the foreword, and I say, and I
you won't
not
say
to
it.
Be cute, no,
just
but I tell you why.
Yeah,
I had an understanding with the gentleman Luc in the mm-hmm. who runs the piano shop in the book. Uh-huh. That I would not reveal where it is because he said I don't want the public showing up at my door.
And to this day,
he just is very French.
Yeah,
and I respected that. And it's just an undertaking that I made. And you know, I haven't told anybody, so don't feel singled out, please. But it's just you could.
I thought maybe tonight was the night. I thought maybe you.
No, sorry, no. I just no. It's I gave my word, and
it's probably on the right bank, right? Is that?
You're a reporter, right?
Okay, any more questions? Well, I've got one I'd like to ask just about yourself. I mean, you've been in, you spent quite a bit of your childhood in France, and then you've come back, came back in the late 80s, and you've been here more or less ever since. I just wondering, do you feel almost as French as you do American, or have you kept that sort of the solid grounding of having an American family and American origins?
I think the latter. And not by design, but by happenstance. I'm in no danger of being taken for a Frenchman. And, you know, some people do look more or less French, or could, and they, you can dress that way and so forth, but I don't pass. And it doesn't bother me. It sometimes is interesting when you meet new French people and they don't expect you to speak fluent French. Mm-hmm. And so that, but that's just language, you know, and it's neither here nor there. But I think our own children went through the French system. And so if anything, they went, all their whole scolarité was in France, in the French system. So they were more grounded in French and in the French system than I was, certainly. And there's more of a, I wouldn't call it a divide, but a duality for them. But even so, I think when you speak English at home, or your whatever language you speak at home, the language you speak en famille is the one that grabs you. Mm-hmm. I'm sure there are people who have different experiences, but that's been my experience, and we've never made a point of trying to change that, and so it hasn't changed.
And as a sort of a follow-up question, do you notice things about your personality which might be considered your French side? Like things that, for example, when you go back to the United States, that sort of seem particularly French to the people you know there?
People, I don't see it, but they certainly do. Actually, it's funny because the more than anything, people say you have certain gestures or facial expressions that you don't see, which I'd never thought of, but apparently I do that more than I ever imagined. And it's, I don't know if it's particularly French, although I think I probably learned that in France, and whether I use it appropriately, I don't do it consciously, but nobody does that in America apparently. So, but I don't, it's funny, in terms of self-awareness, very little. Things strike me as strange, but then things always strike me as strange when I go to the U.S. It's one of the great things about the U.S. is it changes rapidly. And so on a linguistic level, what I was talking about, the last part of my remarks, you know, that whole in-between thing, with my own children, I know that there were just language things that would change very much more quickly than you would expect. And you wouldn't know. Let me see if I can think of an example. I know one was, there was this expression, I don't know if it was 10 or 15 years ago, you go girl, you go girl. That was some expression, which, and if you don't watch American TV or you're in the vernacular, it's spoken language. It's not a question of judging. It's just the way language, and particularly English, has that great capacity to adapt. And American English is just rapid. But I had no idea. I think I was on the phone one time, and they said, "You go, girl," and said, "What?" What? Or then even when you see it printed, and then I had a French friend who asked me, okay, this is often the way it comes to you also, is they will see it before I will, say, "C'est quoi, you go, girl?" I said, "Well," and I said, "I don't know. What? Let's find out." And, you know, you want the grammar of it and so forth. And I thought, no, this is too crazy. It's just the way American English proceeds, some of it poorly and some of it in a more interesting way. But it's that distinction, I think, is very different. And I'm sure French has some of that, but not, it seems to me, quite the same pace. And so that sometimes strikes me right in the face. And you go, well, I don't know my own language. When you're away from it, in that sense, it does make a difference.
And I think we have time. Yeah, one more question.
I'm just curious, as you go back to Fontainebleau now, does it strike you as familiar, different? How does it feel like the place where you grew up? Or I'm just sort of curious on your view as you go back there.
I'd say all of those things. That's a good way of, you know, it's familiar. It's definitely familiar. It's the place I grew up, even though we only lived there for 3 years. But it was where I, it's partly my age, too, because I was lucky. I've had, of course, you don't know when you're the lucky one, but I was from 4 to 7. And apparently that's just a perfect age to learn another language. And so when I went to French school, it kind of imprinted in without my, it's not that I didn't have to work at it, but unlike my siblings who had more of a grounding in English and in English schools, it just came at me as, you know, this is how you're going to learn math, or this is how you're, this is the alphabet. So familiar, I think, is the way it feels. It hasn't changed that much. And the chateau, they've done a lot to restore it, but you wouldn't know it from the outside. You'd have to know the particulars. So it's very encouraging in a way. It's something that's, and 1137 is a long time ago. I'm not that young at all, but even in my lifetime, it's just a drop in the bucket compared to that stretch of time. I think it's encouraging to have a culture, to be in a culture that values and orients itself to something that significant, and then uses it as a way of teaching some of those lessons. That's just my personal feeling.
And just to finish, of course, you won't tell us where the piano shop is, but I wondered if on the subject of Fontainebleau...
I'll tell you where the chateau is.
Could you tell us maybe your favorite spot there? Like when you visit the chateau again, is there a particular room? Is there a particular part of the grounds?
There is, you've got to read the book, Adam. No, I not to be cute. I do talk about this in the book, and actually I did a book tour in the U.S. and two different times, actually, people said, how can you say that? What I said is the ballroom in Fontainebleau. I call it the most beautiful room in France. And to my mind, it is. I have not seen all the beautiful rooms in France by any means, but I've seen many of them, as many of you have. And there's something about that room when you walk into it, to me, that is extraordinary. There's no room like it. I'd say anywhere that I've seen, and maybe there is, its exact opposite is in Las Vegas, probably. But my response really was, and is, one of the advantages, perhaps the only advantage of being a writer when you write in about a specific, a real place, is that you get to have your own reaction, and if you can communicate that, that's what you're trying to do. Certainly in nonfiction or narrative nonfiction, that's what I try to do. And so I don't apologize for that. I do feel very strongly, but it's also not a competition. You know, my room against yours or something, but to come to your question, that would be the place. It's to me, I would strongly encourage you, when you go to Fontainebleau, the one thing I'll say as a caveat is call before, because the salle de bal is not always open, which is hugely frustrating. You go, oh, Thad Carhart told us to come see the salle de bal, and it's not open that day. So they have a strange scheduling thing, which is supposedly getting better, but that's something you want to check.
Now, just as you can't have a French maths textbook without bottles of wine, you can't have a reading in a bookshop in France without wine being served afterwards, which is what we're going to be doing now. So please do stick around for a glass of wine. I'm sure Thad would be delighted to sign copies of Finding Fontainebleau.
Or talk to you or whatever you like.
Indeed, continue the conversation. So please, everyone, join me in giving it up one more time for Thad Carhart.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Adam.